Fourth thing is the poor person of our nation, agriculture and livestock management. The fifth thing is rural development, sixth thing is environment, seventh thing is the energy, nuclear technology, and the eighth thing is the life sciences, ninth thing is the biotechnology and emerging science once more, and the 11th is modern medicine. And the next two things are electronics, and the final thing is space exploration or space technology or science. So we have taken everything. This is a wide array or an array of various other, as I already told, eternal, existing and emerging trends in the world. And according to Shastras, we must throw some light. We are given the topic as hopes and hazards. In that particular aspect, I want to give you three questions. There are some particular areas where the conception level itself is hazardous. It is known as conceptive hazard. Second thing, where the concept is not hazardous, it is ambivalent, it can be both hopeful and hazardous. Where the systematic apprehension, preservation, security measures and application methodologies can prevent the hazards and increase the hopes. That is just application hazard. And in application hazard also, there are two possibilities. One, if it is hazardous, which is more when comparable to the other, is the hazard more than the hope or hope more than the hazard? If there is hope more than the hazard and hazard is infinitesimal, whether the hazard can be mitigated or kept under control or not, pariharaniya and pariharaniya, whether it can be controllable or not. If the controllability or the possibility of control is beyond doubt, if there are a lot of checks and balances, that is okay. Whether there have to be for the milk booth appointing the guardian who is none but a milk lover in the form of a cat, when the persons, that is the creator of technology, the caretakers of technology, guardians of technology, instigators of technology, involvers in technology, preachers and teachers of technology, trainers in technology, appliers in technology and consumers of technology, when major of these portions are these people in the portions, they are possible as they are having human instincts. They may be subjected to awareness, fear, which are the most unavoidable binary compounds of all human beings, which tempts the person either to go for wrong ways or to observe silence at the time of wrong deeds. So whether these things are verily possible or not, that must be pondered. So first is conceptive hazard, second thing is application hazard, in which controllability, uncontrollability are pondered as two major issues. Let us enter into energy. According to Shastras, each and every unit of energy is supplied by God. But whenever we can pray God, but whenever we want to apply energy, we have to be dependent on the natural sources, unavoidably. The sources of energy, whenever you see, whenever there is a benefit in an act, I used to always say this example, whenever there is water, there will be fish. Whenever there is fish, there will be a competition between the fisherman and his net and a crane and his beak. So there will be some sort of competition. If there is energy, energy is applied. If something is applied, it has a product. Something has a product, it will have a benefit. If something has a benefit, it will result in economy. If there is economy, it will result in power. And power is the center of political hub or political kleptocracy and diplomacy, which will form the nucleus of all unwanted things. So apart from science, the person must understand politics and economy, which forms the real fortification of all of our scientific implantations. Without understanding these other two beings, a mere science spectator will be just an idiot, swan idiot by himself. He can neither establish, nor he can create, nor he can judge, nor he can practically see anything without the assistance of the other two factors. So energy, it is nothing but power, and if it is dominated by a second power known as political power, then it will create a lot of crises. Power crisis is not only vested in earth, but also from application units. For example, recently met a red, Vladimir Putin has written a statement. If anybody is going to ask any questions from the European community regarding my war against Georgia, immediately I am going to flow all of my resources, energy resources into the Far East. This is a thrust. And this type of thrusting the energy to somebody, 1973, there was an energy crisis. Why did it happen? It is war. 1979, the Iranian revolution. Then 1919, the Gulf revolution or Gulf war will happen. So energy crisis everywhere. Energy means power. Power means politics. Politics means crisis. This is the proper definition of all energy centers. Now God has given there are Panchamahabhutas. And there are three bhutas which are not easily subjected to depletion. There are two bhutas subjected to depletion. Achedya and Chedya. Akasha, Vata and Agni. Air, as well as space, as well as fire. Those things are having inexhaustibility. Nobody can say that Akasha will be put to an end. Akasha crisis or air crisis or fire crisis, we cannot say. Air, we can say about the quality of air. Air pollution may be there. We won't leave even that. Who said that you are inexhaustible? I will intrude with pollution. So these things can be done. But naturally, that energy sources are inexhaustible. Whereas the energy sources from the other two things, water and air, they are subject to limitations. And it depends upon our utilities. And due to these various unavoidabilities, pollution in the fossil fuels, and which has resulted in the form of various other political and mismanagement issues. They used to say oil or the petroleum economy of the Middle East economy is the backbone of energy now. Because very successfully most of the other energy resources are not being implemented. So mainly they are, now they have started with something like thermal power and wind power. Now they are trying to build something and as soon as the auspicious time they have started the windmills, replacing only a gentle breeze and not a proper wind force at all. Now they have started in a cradle all the other sources of power. So their major some policies as depicted by energy consultants in the world, number one is monopoly. Monopoly, it is sub-political energy or force. If government does that is known as monarchy. If somebody with power of money and status and influence the government, if the person does, it is known as monopoly. Both are monarchy, both are monos. And because of these reasons, monopoly, then there will be agitation and strike. Then there is pipeline damage. Then there is infrastructural damage. Then there is the natural depletion. Then there is growing demand and limited supply. There are uncountable such things we are facing in the energy crisis. So now we are thinking about the other possibilities of biomass, biofuels, fuel cells, hydrogen fuel, liquid nitrogen fuel, hydro power, tidal power, wave power, wind power, innumerable things they are contemplating. And there is the Integral Energy Policy of 2006. They have given a very proper report which is there in the pipeline or policy itself. For example, India's capability, that is solar potential, is 600 gigawatts. Likewise, 60 million hectares are allowed for cultivation of biofuels. These are just in the record. And Muppandal, you know that it is a place in Tamil Nadu, Uttaranadu, they have made successfully the windmill venture in that area. So something they have been doing. And for oil, you know, they are in hunt with these energy people, they are now in hunt for oil. Regarding gaseous problem, they have made a pipeline project from Iran, Pakistan, India, and that project is in the pipeline itself. And like that, energy project of India, it is there in solar, in wind, in hydropower, innumerable things that they are contemplating. And according to Shastras, I want to complete in the 13th technology of Zodiac, which is known as life technology. All the other technologies are there, but how to live with those technologies and how to lead others to live and make others live and how to live with others. How to live, how to live with others, how to make others live, how to live your generations for life. These four answers are there only in life technology and unfortunately these things are not taught either in your domestic or in your academic or in your social atmospheres. And unfortunately we have been deviated or a contrary exposure is created in all of these atmospheres. That we are going to complete there. Second thing is defense. According to Shastra, what is that? There is nothing known as defense at all. We have to fence us with some radiation. How to fence ourselves? By compassion, by policy, by potentialization, by vitalization, by dialogue. If you fence yourself, then everybody will be defensive. They will be defensive in such a manner that they will extend their arms of cooperation. Good people will extend their arms of cooperation, and evil and malicious things will bind their hands, fold their hands with fear, and they will be submissive to us. This is the real defense. So defense is meant for preventing, protecting, controlling, minimizing, and offering security, and also wage a war to restore peace if needed. So defense is not only anti-war movement. At a time of an offensive attack, a proper means of defensive attack, the means of which we can move for a war to restore peace, that is also in defense. So defense that also deals with intra-security or internal security management and disruptive control. Whenever you see defense, you must not see the defense as by unarmed machines or armed machines, arsenal and other missiles. These things are not components of what we call defense. Apart from that, there is a capability which I am going to say at the end. There is a capability by which these things can be prevented and well designed in the process of debilitation. Apart from defense, government is spending exorbitant amount in defense. In education, in infrastructure management, in employment and empowerment of the rural areas, in fighting against infant mortality, malnutrition and other evils, that TB is not totally concentrated at all because of the unavoidability of defense. So preventive measures in defense is very less, and attack measures, and also it is a process. According to the latest trend of wars, there are different types of wars: cheap war, smart war, ugly war, direct war, remote war systems are there. What is a smart war? It is very interesting to know that all the other major power sectors, they will either construct lot of defense mechanism or post that they have constructed or they are holding lot of defense mechanism, which will tempt the urge of developing countries or underdeveloped countries to purchase lot of things and to increase them with defense, which will weaken the economy so that the other government, either in the pretext of trade contact or policy contact or mutual treaties, they will enter and they will disturb the country and they will suck out the benefit from the country. It is not a smart war. Cheap war is, I am not going to wage war. There are always local people available, our brother people available, with lot of worshipable instincts like existentialism, fundamentalism, separatism, chauvinism, and all isms except patriotism. There are lot of people available in the society. They will be funded by so-called intelligence society, and by inducing them and to create chaos in the country is known as cheap war. And ugly war is cultural intrusion and infiltration. Direct war, we know it is military invasion. So this is the process by which they are doing all of these things. Now when you see about the internal security management, wherever you see lot of infiltrations, lot of terrorist activities are happening, who is going to prevent that? Without the support of the local people, there are three steps in terrorism or disruptivism. One is infiltration. Second thing is socialization. Third is execution. Those people, those who are infiltrating inside, they mix with the common people, and without the help of like-minded people here, they cannot execute anything. So for that we have to create such a system which can prevent all of these things. So according to the modern trend, recently the security advisor has restored, I will accept that the intelligence is insufficient regarding the latest attack. I want to give two examples or definitions for superior intelligence and two definitions for inferior intelligence. Superior intelligence is not only having its own intelligence, but also having collaborative intelligence with social intelligence. Each and every social member must constitute within himself a symptom of vigilance, a symptom of patriotism, a symptom of productive benevolence towards the country. They must develop some sort of intelligence. And the public and the intelligence coordination is known as coordinated intelligence. And only that will meet how many people are there in military and intelligence, and how many people can watch each and every person like a watchdog. Unless the public and the people, they are trained, they are tuned, they are vaccinated with ethical principles and nation level principles and understanding of each and every role in national development, it is very hard for this intelligence to work. So real intelligence is preventive intelligence. Real intelligence is collaborative intelligence. What is preventive? Every time they must be prepared. They must not be expecting any email communication or any informal communication for bombing. Somebody told that a bank in Hyderabad is targeted, it does not mean that Delhi can be totally excluded. They must be ever prepared, like daily bath and daily brushing the teeth. Vigilance and preparatory methods are also daily routine, and we must be having instant vigilance and we must be carrying, governing each and everything. action belief, it must be vigilant. So we must be ever prepared in the preventive mode. So protective, preventive and ever prepared must be the mode of defense. Second thing I will draw to be told, collaborative. This is superior intelligence. Inferior intelligence is entirely different. Inferior intelligence works when the opponent is an idiot. So it does not work upon the person's intelligence at all. Second thing, inferior intelligence is always thinking that he is intelligent. So when a person just over-evaluates the person and he shines with his intelligence when somebody is in idiocy, then that is inferior intelligence. Now in defense development, we are having a lot of other things. We are hearing that there is going to be a France tie-up for military relations and military benefits. Now there is a Falcon they have bought for $1.1 billion. So likewise, millions and millions are invested in dollars for purchase of a lot of things. It is just for our safety, security, and moreover it is for your prestige that we are also a developing country, we are also a developed country. Not for protection, most of the things are purchased only for prestige issue. I told about in one conference the nature of superpower. Superpower is the status of a country which must create a comfort in the minds of our neighbors, and it must create also solace in the mind of our dependents and subjects, which must create fear and threat in the minds of intruders. If it totally creates a fear and insecurity in the minds of all people, irrespective of the subjects or the opponents, then what is that superpower? Superpower is not a fear casting force like a demon, a dragon or something else. Kathir Madhyam, O Muhattan, so says Anda. Likewise, we must create a fear in the mind of the intruders, in the minds of the benevolent subjects. That is really superpower. Now they are having Israel government and military people, they are coming for training these people in counter-terrorism exercises. Now South African and France Navy people, they are coming for training these people. So international coordination for precision training and for, no doubt, enriching the status of arsenal by means of purchase, all of these things are entirely different. But Shastra says that peacemaking is by different methods. One is peacemaking by economical equality, by providing opportunities for education, employment, etc. That is the first process of peacemaking, in fact. The second process is policy making, by which we can understand the border between India is surrounded by all neighbors. And all neighbors are the disruptive elements. Either holding the disruptive elements and they are totally against India, most of the people. Somebody told recently they have been to one Middle East. Then the person was asked by a small child, maybe reading that is LKG or LKG, she may be studying. She just asked, are you an Indian? And he humbly replied, yes, he was a very grown person, having gone for a job or something else. And that small kid that has not buttered even. And immediately it replied, vehemently, we are going to shoot you one day. So this is the methodology of education, and the implant bitterness and happiness for these countries. We have to create, they have to also create a better atmosphere in which the bitterness is removed and a reasonable understanding. We need not be too much fraternized, and it is always dangerous. It is worse than hostility. So that must be a reasonable understanding between these countries. So second is policy making. That is also very much essential. And peacemaking, policy making, and then the protection or the prevention forces, they have to be involved. So this is what the Shastras say about the defense. The third thing is our bridegroom information technology. The process of data storage, preservation and security privacy issues, by technical methodology is known as information technology. No doubt it gives all benefits. Now recently they have reported 5.2% is the GDP, and 18.6% of growth is reported, 64 million of transactive wealth, and there is $11 billion of annual revenue. 38% of the outsourcing is done from our country because of our voluntary slavery. And it is known as the policy of hunt for Indian talent. It is a trend of the Western world now. Hunt for Indian talent, because labor is there, government cooperation is wherever there is money, government will cooperate. If there is a temple with no lamb or oil, the government will not come there. If there is a temple with richness, with splendor, and with a gamut of various festive occasions, immediately the department will be sanctioned there, it will be stationed there. So likewise, each and everything that is productive, government will be there. That's where labor, then talent of people, education level, English language, soft skills in communication. I have already talked about the government coordination, then the infrastructure management. All of these things have resulted that India will be the paradise for getting manpower resources. Now the 100 top listed companies, 29 companies are there in our country for services. These things are entirely different. Let us see about the hazards. Number one, it gives uneven employment. As it is giving some benefit, everybody is running after the IT industry. There are three industries which are confusing the people, crushing them, totally it grinds the belly but it drains the brain. One is IT, they are also rhythmic in nature. IT, IIT, IIIT, expert IT. The proper way of balancing, you see, it is extremism. If you want to do something, there is a compound methodology. You have your family, you have your instincts, you have instincts for recreation, relaxation, rest, retrospection, introspection. So a human being has a compound life. If you invest everything for a compound life, like getting money or overseas settlement or graduation or promotion or unlawful enrichment or mortgage investment or enrichment by which you invest your health, wealth, mentality, family relations, harmony, everything you invest on wealth. What is that? It is a component style of life. So the first thing is uneven employment. Everybody is going for the same thing, due to which good engineers, especially for there is a plasma science is there is polymer science is there, immunology is there, bioinformatics is there, mechanical engineering is there. Even for normal things, no persons are available now. And in the forthcoming decade, no persons will be available also. It is uneven employment. Second thing is emotional erosion. See, machines are responding to you without wish and will. Whereas all the living beings in the bionic field, in science we used to call it as a bionic field, they have wish and will. They have some sort of mutuality, understanding, fraternity, possibility, all of these things, varieties of tests are there. If a person is doing two wrong things, sitting before the computers or any machine, that cannot be prevented, that has become a part of life. We cannot amputate it. But there must be a limitation, number one. Second, other components of life, they must also be paid attention. Unless this thing is not done, immediately you get emotional erosion. You cannot understand what is forgiving things, what is loving things, what is harmonizing things, what is feeling gratitude, love, affection, sincerity, obedience, loyalty, everything will be lost. You will be losing the time to think all these things and also the ability to relish and digest all these things, emotional erosion. Third thing is physical debilitation. You will be getting repetitive stress, injury, you will be getting optical stress. Then you will be getting positional awkwardness, you will be getting joint pain, back pain, you will be invading all the diseases inside you. That is also a very great thing. Fourth thing is brutal growth. One sector that grows brutally, trampling on the other sectors. It is an uneven growth. If a person knows alone grows, seeing his bodyhood, without leaving the other portions, you know how awkward it will be. So it is a brutal growth in the society. That is also the blessing of IT industry. So like this, there are innumerable things, hazardous things are also there. And the final thing is uncertainty. Do you think that IT industry is going to support you? It is an illusory sheet. It is going to leave everybody. If a person is just jumping from the first floor, reasonably he can just get some services done in the Puttur hospital. Then it is from the top floor, 20th or 24th, is very dangerous. These people, they are being focused only for IT training. When abnormal circumstances occur, what are the abnormal circumstances? Number first, it is work minimization or recruitment minimization. Yes, it is happening. They have started minimizing three things. Taking works minimized, recruitment minimized, training minimized. In Satyam Infosys, they have minimized. That is minimization. And the second thing is closure. Most of the companies, they will close. And they are now closing some companies also. Then, nativity adoption. Now there is a lot of unemployment problems at US itself. Now there is an agitation that they must employ those people and not outsource these programs here. So lot of options in outsourcing. Now the people of France, Korea, Japan and China, they are learning English. They are learning the English accentuation and voice delivery communication system through voice activation methodologies. Now they are qualifying themselves. Then they will be an Asian competitor. The nativity people, they are just testing the government, which has assured them that most of the outsourcing will be insourced within the available realm itself. The third thing, I have already told, closure. Fourth thing is upgrade. If you are that is upgradation. Then the fifth thing is effective replacement. They will be effectively going to replace somebody else, due to which you will be thrown out at all. So all of these various reasons, they result in uncertainty. And now there is a book known as Fool's Gold. Do you know what is known? We have heard about Mekana's Gold. What is Fool's Gold? Computer is known as Fool's Gold. Lot of hazardous things are there from computers. It must be just all of these things must be expressed in a separate lecture. How it is known as, why it is known as Fool's Gold? Because of its radiation, because of its addiction, adaptive addiction. It makes us not to realize something by listening, seeing, observation. The preliminary skills of human apprehension or cognitive learning that is prevented by a mechanical way of seeing something in a screen. So the person is not ready to see even the mother, only monitor. He is not handling any food except mouse. And fortunately he is eating food, not any other mother dough or chips. So except that, the person is so much engrossed in the system. So it is known as Fool's Gold. It is information technology. Now we have to come to agriculture and food security. Agriculture is the basis of our life. Without agriculture, we cannot survive in our life. So agriculture must be paid proper attention. Food security must be paid proper attention. Due to lack of food security, now we are having malnutrition, hunger deaths, and a quantitative and qualitative reduction in food production. Apart from that, there are three more hazards. Production hazard, I have already told. Then supply the hazard and distribution hazard. The public distribution system, it has announced that 33% of the distributed grains are kept in storage. Yesterday at KG Hospital, I have been explaining something. Nindaka, one who ill-treats food. Yartaka, one who wastes food. Ekaki, one who isolatedly or solitarily consumes the food without distributing to others. Vishami, one who is taking the food with partiality. And Apaharta, one who is smuggling or misappropriating food. Vikreta, one who is selling or making for a profit over food. All of these reasons will create the indigestibility or inadaptability of food and food starch, which is in the form of diabetes mellitus. Second thing is vyadhi. The vyadhi that is there in the form of lot of pests which are controlling the growth or spoiling the growth of all of your food grains. Then kshama. Kshama is a drought or famine. Then kshaya is degradation. These things are gifted only by your habitual mismanagement. So this is also taken into consideration in the security things. According to the report of FAO, they have clearly given 852 million people are suffering due to extreme poverty and hunger, and 2 billion people are suffering due to malnutrition. So this is whenever you eat food, you cannot feed all people. But whenever you eat food, you have to think that it is possible, and it is not an eye wash or a lip service. If you think, that's what I told. For you, you work. For others, you try. For the world, you pray. So we have to work for us. We have to pray for others within our might, and we have to pray for the world. For 852 million people can be supplied, but we can pray for the welfare. With the prayer's benefits, they will get good turnovers or turning points in political revolution or renaissance, economic renaissance, support from other nations. Some dawn will be given by God as an effect of your real wholehearted prayer. So this is understanding of real value of food. And agriculture, now there are four types of lands. One is the land which must be for timber, for your construction and other things. Second is for food. Third is for herbal medicines. Now there is a competition, biofuel. Everywhere you cultivate biofuel, what will be eating? There must be a reasonable and rational proportion between food, medicine, fuel and timber. It is what the Shastra said. And if you take land, lot of landscapes, they are totally put into depletion. About more than 4.7 to 12 billion tons of soil, it is wasted every year. 60% of the alluvial soil that is wasted now. Environmental degradation. If you come to water, there is water scarcity also. They have predicted already a water crisis by 2010. Now, there is a natural process of losing of water through wells and ponds and by rainwater. As you have made compressor pumps, totally all the water plates, all the water surfaces inside there, they are depleted. Now we are thinking that this compression methodology of getting water for It is a nonsense and nuisance to their bounty. By getting compressed water, why will the water table at all? Most of the places, water table is gone. Most of the forests of Madhya Pradesh and North East, they are subjected to environmental degradation, afforestation. By means of agriculture, by means of industrialization, globalization, colonization and urbanization policies. Now water is in scarcity in Punjab, Haryana and Uttar Pradesh, where due to this overcompression of water, groundwater water, that has resulted in that. So this is environmental degradation, which resulted in global warming process also, by your pollution, by automobiles, by chemical these things, and by misapplication of the energy forces, and the hazardous forces that are released by the byproducts as the inevitable result or residue of various processing forces of petroleum and other things in the manufacture of fertilizers in various other processes. The outputs, byproducts, the residue, they are very hazardous. Moreover, we are polluting, we are inducing the global warming by negative thoughts of hostility, non-fraternity. At least 25% of the global warming is caused by your inner irritation. That is only warming the globe. The inner irritation, the inner heat of human body, intolerability of somebody's development by means of jealousy, hostility, not supporting people, lack of harmony, understanding, to in the family, how to work with the society. All of these things, 25% they contribute. So this is environment as well as to deal with agriculture and food security. Then I want to say a few words about the rural. What is rural and what is urban? Wherever there is a basic resources, that area is known as rural. Wherever the rural sources are processed, that is known as urban. So they used to always call what is urban society, where there is accessibility to commodities and services and connectivity for mobility, that is known as per concept, that is known as urban society. But real harmony, real peace and real beauty, that rests only in rural beauty. Whatever we are seeing in richness and beauty, it is synthetic beauty and synthetic richness, whatever we see in urban society, and the real beauty rests only in these places. And unfortunately, the rural people, they are also having some deficiencies. That is malnutrition integrity. Second thing is integrity, lack of integrity. So innumerable things are there. They are integral, the village people, but that is malnutrition. To kill somebody after 5 immediately, they will be integrated. For productive things, they are not integrated. Integrity, but malnutrition integrity and lack of integrity. They are having crude emotions and they are having craze also. They are having innocence and ignorance. These six unavoidable qualities within the rural community is the main reason for rural exploitation by multinational companies and by governments. Political parties misuse that for vote banking, and MNC people, why they are building roads, why they are expanding villages, not for benefiting the villager people. Without developing the ability for purchase, you have craze and emotional urge, the taste for new things, they are misused by these companies by putting roads and by establishing centers, by selling those things. They are really exploited. Real savior must come for empowerment, education, employment of all those people. So certainly we have to purchase 1 acre of land. For each and every person, they have to purchase 1 acre of land. They must restore into peace and also they must cultivate their own food and enjoy. Now cultivation is a problem. If everybody can understand the rural bounty of earth, certainly the season will be favorable to us, pests will be under our control, water will be fighting no scarcity, the nature will be very amicable to us. If you are really progressive in mind and collaborating with the co-inhabitants of the society. So this is a process by which we have to live in a village. But there are two problems. Whenever we are going to move to village, the village must be prevented from being contaminated already or even after you are killed there. So these two things are the major hazards. So this is also the rule. Then coming from nuclear reactors, I think that yes, 15 minutes. No, you don't know the solution. The next thing is nuclear. We know that nuclear energy comes from the energy release of atomic nuclei by means of fission, fusion and radioactive decay. And you know that as infinite energy charge, then release of the energy is infinite. So the storage is also different and difficult. Then application is also different and difficult. So if the energy is infinite, then the storage, then the application, then the impact, everything will be different and difficult to manage. It is very natural. And according to the modern trend, the advocates of nuclear energy, they say that, you see, electricity, now we have seen twice the departure of electricity. So there are a lot of electric cuts. And second thing, fossil fuels are subjected to depletion. That is one or oil tank that is available. It is known as Almerca. It is going to deplete in 40 years, just now they have indicated. Likewise, it will be depleted at one time, number two. And number three, those things they generate lot of these unwanted gases and high metal or heavy metal gases, which will contribute to global warming. So to get a clean energy, nuclear energy is a new clean energy. As per the advocates of nuclear energy, they say so. But there are lot of movement. They saw some sort of incompatibility with those things and they started some movements. Anti-nuclear movement. Nuclear free energy, nuclear free world. So there are also people with contrary experiences. What they say is, number one, it is not reliable by 3 hours. It will also be depleted. For example, India, it has 1% of uranium and 21% of thorium. So it will be depleted. At one stage, it is also subjected to depletion. It is unavoidable, that is first thing. And second thing, even for the devices, how far they are reliable? For example, there is one Japan Steel Works company which is making the central part of the nuclear container vessel, which must be a single blend or it must be a single die. It cannot be fixed with joints because that will result in the hazard of leakage. Now that company is in problem, by which now they are suffering, but still there is a sodium cooled safe reactor or a speed reactor has been recently invented for avoiding this type of Japan Steel Works problem, by which a single overhead structure for the container is a middle part can be prepared by means of joints also without having the leakage. So reliability is there in combination of the reactors, container vessels, holding storage devices and application devices and emission devices. That is the second reliability. Third is the non-reliability of the persons those who are going to use it. There is nothing known as civil nuclear energy and military nuclear energy at all. Civil and military nuclear energy are the uses of energy. They are not the names of energy. There is nothing known as civil energy and military energy. There is nothing, no knife known as a knife to cut vegetables and knife to cut the throat. All things are the same. It depends upon the fortune of either the vegetable or the person. So likewise, if it is subjected to non-reactors or non-state reactors, immediately it is going to be hazardous. It is the problem of reliability. Then it is cost efficiency. It is hyper expensive, cost wise. Third thing is environmental degradation is also possible. Fourth thing is the safety. What is environmental degradation? The waste that is coming from that nuclear reactor is a byproduct. That waste is having high level of energy and low level energy also. And that radioactivity cannot be stopped at all and it cannot be preserved also. By preservation, it requires lot of labor, lot of concentration and lot of risk factor also. It is too much expensive, though that is environmental. It may cause accidents like explosions or due to sabotage or due to your health policies or already we are very healthy genetically. If you work in the nuclear station, you will be disturbed by the nuclear radiations also. Then apart from these, there is one more thing. It is vulnerability to attack. There are possibilities for being attacked by disruptive forces. And sixth thing is the byproduct can be misused by any person as a weapon. For all of these things, they are told that nuclear energy is no clear energy. So this was totally against the nuclear philosophy, the advocates for nuclear energy. Then we have to come to life sciences and biotechnology. It is very much essential to know about these things because we are living beings. What are life sciences? Innumerable things. Starting with it is biology, cytology, histology, tissue engineering, tissue sciences, cell biology, molecular biology, microbiology, immunology, genomics, genome mapping, embryology, all of these various sciences, they compositely form the life sciences. So we must understand something. All non-living beings, they are having some understanding. That is known as abiotic rhythm. All living beings, homogenetically, they are having a rhythm, biotic rhythm. Heterogenetic qualities, they are having symbiotic rhythm. So it is known as cosmobiosis or global rhythm. So all the achetana, chetana and sarva chetana, mishra chetana, all of these various sentient, insentient, infrasentient, ultra-sentient, subsentient species, they are having mutual understanding and intra-organized understanding. So we cannot consider the way God has created these are various constructed this thing, what he has made, what he has made, what he has made. Like the innumerable things of that, each and everybody, they have a purpose, except human being. Yesterday, no, he has a purpose, but he is not executing. Yesterday, I told, human being is a macro parasite. He consumes the benefit from all living beings and contributes nothing. Satmak is the greatest of human life. So lives are important to understand all lives. That way the Shastra says there are 84 lakhs of species. If you want to understand all species, it will take 84 lakhs of births. To understand one life spirit which has contributed to these all life species. That is universal spirit or Brahman. So Veda, they have adopted the philosophy to understand the universal spirit, understanding which everything is quite known reasonably. It is not understanding the heart, the liver, lung, all of these nonsensical things. It is understanding the fruit and purpose of the potential existence or a contributing existence of a totalitarian view of all organisms. Regarding biotechnology, they are having innumerable biotechnology. Blue biotechnology is in aquatic measures. Red biotechnology is in medicine. Green biotechnology is in agriculture. White biotechnology is in chemicals. Innumerable biotechnologies are there. So they are totally concentrating on the development of food science, the development of productive agriculture, and development of human life standards by means of medicines. So the medicinal values are coming in the form of pharmacogenomics, drugs, genetic detection or testing, and by therapeutical usages. And in agriculture, they are just meant for developing six major things according to Shastras. Krishi Parasana says the same thing. One is developing a taste, dandha ruchi vardhanam, to develop the taste, appearance and other things. To reduce the stress, to reduce the environmental stress, and to see that it is hyperproductive, to see that it is nutritious, and to see that novel things can be developed inside. So these six things are told in Krishi Parasana. That is Yuthamiya, Shakti Vardhana, Balavardhana, Gunavardhana, Ojavardhana, all of these things are stated in Krishi Parasara, which is the purpose of this modern biotechnologies. Now they have developed inbuilt novelty, just as we are having in BTCon. Instead of getting pesticides from outside, BTCon creates its own pesticide, its own response, it can create its own homeostasis. That is possible by this thing, this BTCon. And for human beings also, you know about E. coli. Yes, it is a synthetic insulin which has been prepared. But there is a problem in this thing also, the hazard is limited knowledge we are having on genes. With limited knowledge we cannot get inside. I want to tell you a small story. Somebody was sitting on the top of the copper wall of a well. Just a person is telling 20, 20, 20, 20 and the person, the traveler, he thought that he is counting some mantra. Then he approached the person and asked why he is counting 20. Then that person pushed this person inside and started counting 21, 21, 21. So with limited knowledge, with the genes, genome behavior, opposite, genetically modified crops are there, genetically modified organisms are there. How far they are reliable? Will they have eternal approach? Will they have limited approach or ephemeral approach? Will they have eternal approach or everlasting approach? Are they in the disguise of benefit or really beneficial? These things cannot be understood by limited perception or limited proofs at all. We have to wait for generations and observe. How you can see the genetic class now? Unless you watch very observatively, unless you watch two or three generations and deeply probe into the issue, how you can understand these things? So limited knowledge, cost efficiency, side effects, and not assured you, these are the reasons by which biotechnology has been also put into draw. Then we are coming to modern medicine. What is the quality of any healthy person? The Shastra says that he must be drug minimal or drug evasive. The second thing is he must be having surgical evasion or surgical minimization. Third thing is eco-collateralism or eco-parallelism. You must adhere to nature, but you are gifted with salubrity. That is the third thing. And fourth thing, by means of understanding the nature and behavior of his own self by means of control. Fifth is to take all preventive measures. The first or final thing is known as medicine. So these things are the five major instincts that are to be developed in the global community for health awareness and disease prevention in real world. Somebody told, there is a book known as Death by Medicine. There is a book known as Death by Medicine, and it is a bestseller as well as an eye-opener. Generally, medicine is meant for life and extension of longevity. But death is caused in modern days by medicine. That is the statement. Because the medicine is like that. There are two flaws you have to say. One is the trend flaws and second is the technical flaws. Technical flaws that are coming in the form of machines. Even there are two machines. One is testing machine, second is a treating machine. They are evolving radiations by misappropriation and malappropriations of the person. They are leading to problems. And even the trend, now everybody, there is an ethical degradation everywhere. So these doctors, they also have to do that. And there is a shloka for that. Namastubhyam Vaidya Raja Yamaraja Sahodara Yamastu Harade Pranan Tvam Pranan Dharmi Vacha. I worship you, my family doctor. You are the elder brother for Yama. Because Yama only appropriates my life. You take both my life and money. That is such a shloka. And it happens. It is a medical revolution.
Astrobiology, astrobiochemistry, celestial mechanics, terrestrial engineering, and innumerable things.
things we are in need really? Can we get something that is in abundance there and scarcity here? Can we get new things for our development? How it can be colonized or it can be? How we can create an energy understanding or tie up with other planets? Extraterrestrial invasion or exploration. Second thing is colonization. How to make agriculture, how to make water resources, how to construct buildings there, how to make our farmhouses and industries there, office, so that we can have two principles of life. Happiness and harmony. We are having everything. Giddiness, dizziness, drowsiness, laziness, everything except happiness and wellness. So we must have happiness and harmony in the life. The third thing is health. If you are going to get everything, spoiling your health, I used to repeat this in all lectures. God laughed at human being that in the first half of the life, he spends all of his health for getting wealth. The second half, he spends all of his wealth to get back to the health which was already achieved. So how is it? So third thing is concentrate on developing your health. If somebody is getting 5 lakhs, if the real income is 50,000, 4,50,000 is obtained by sacrificing a greater wealth, which is known as your health or mental peace or certainty. Nothing will come exorbitantly or superfluously. Anything you get more than what you deserve is nothing but the transformation of some other greater ideal, irreparable loss you are getting into. This is the philosophy of cry, call and craving. So third thing is this earth, happiness and harmony and health. This is known as one side growth. So without qualifying the people to be good consumers and good utilizers of science and technology, merely growing the technology what it will result. If somebody is fighting with stone, immediately you are giving AK-47 without changing the mindset of the people. Is it a productive force or productive technology? That is the thing. And then there are four things inevitable. They are known as quadra inevitables. Growth of population, necessity of forces under growth, depletion, misuse. Four things cannot be prevented at any time at all. Forces will be developing, population will be developing, misuse will be developing, depletion is also unavoidable. Shastras say that population must develop, necessity will expand, and you must not use technical methods. How will you be sufficient for the growing population? They are not understanding two natural beauties of earth and wind results, elasticity and plasticity. Earth, more you grow, more you are harmonious, more you are ethical, earth also expands its bounty. The earth giving more to you is known as elasticity. The total structure of the earth producing more resources is known as plasticity of earth. If these things are the two untold or unexperimented attributes or the instinctive munificence of the earth's bounty. So if you are truthful, more timber will be produced, more water will be showered, and more mineral resources will be there manifested. Construction of dams and then biodegradation, all of these various things will not come into account at all. How it is possible? It is possible only by a good governance and global governance. Because we have no power to do things. We can just say how we can implement. So a good governance should come so that the elasticity and plasticity